Good afternoon, this is woodblock printmaker David Bo here at my carving bench in our shop in Asakusa in Tokyo. This video is another in our David's Choice series where I select some interesting items from my own collection to show you. And as you have just seen in that short cold open, today we are going small, very small. When I was a kid, I was a bit of a collector. Maybe most people are, I don't know. There seems to be something about the concept of having things in a set that we just can't resist. For me, about 8, 9, 10 years old, postage stamps were a big part of my life at one stage. You know, I would try and get all the stamps of different denominations that made up a unified set. Books too, I remember reading a juvenile mystery series and trying to get the whole set on my shelf. My mother must have gone nuts at Christmas time and stuff. I even have a memory of one set collecting activity that seems to me now to verge on the bizarre. My brother and I would have been about 10 and he would have been 8 or something. We spent weeks one summer sitting in the grassy median strip of a major highway, the Trans-Canada Highway in Winnipeg, with notebooks in hand. What did we do? We wrote down license plate numbers of the cars zooming by, trying to collect an entire set from all the Canadian provinces and all the American states. I think this probably isn't just me, you know, many people seem to share the same kind of compulsion for collecting things in groups. I think there's even terminology for it used by researchers in psychology. They call it set completion. So what does this have to do with Japanese prints? Well, I guess the answer to that might be kind of obvious. For hundreds of years, publishers here have put out prints in sets of all kinds. 36 views of Mount Fuji, 53 stations of the Tokaido, 100 poets. I don't know that all the customers in those days actually purchased all of the prints in any set. I'm sure that people sometimes must have cherry-picked their favorites. But without question, producing prints in sets was a major part of publishing activities back in the day. Now, put that aside for a moment. We're going to grab a couple of other threads and then weave this all together. Here's a photo of a shrine building not too far from my shop here in Asakusa. This is one of the few buildings in the area that survived the wartime bombings and fires. Do you see here and there the white labels stuck onto the wood? These are fuda, or more commonly, senshafuda. Back in older times, it was very common for visitors to a shrine like this to leave their mark in the form of these labels, which had their name, business name, or family crest. The idea was basically to get good fortune, etc., etc. You know, it's a calling card for the gods. You occasionally see an older shrine ceiling just plastered with these things. People used to bring like a long telescoping stick to paste them up in these high places. This entire practice now, for the most part, is really frowned upon, and all the shrines and temples around here now don't have these labels. Now, where did people get these labels? Well, of course, they would order them from a woodblock print workshop, just in the same way these days we might order a batch of Meishi name cards from a printing company. Now, over time, an interesting thing happened. People started to swap these labels with each other, and as time went by, they even formed organized groups to do this. Now, as the plain black name labels aren't really so interesting, bit by bit, they started to include color and imagery. And somewhere along the line, it seems to have happened in about the 1880s, this format became standardized. And from Meiji through Taisho, on into Showa, right up until the war, many, many, many such collectors' groups came into being, and they were responsible for commissioning many, many thousands upon thousands of these prints. Now, at the same time that this was happening, and organized by many of the same people, yet another format of collectible little prints was coming into being. These had their origin not in shrines and temples, but at the other end of society, in bars and drinking places. Pretty much everyone who visited such a place back then was a smoker, and the hostess stood by to light their cigarettes. The boxes of matches were passed out, and of course the matchbox was always labeled with the name and address of the establishment. Now, there's nothing specifically Japanese about this, and if I do a quick search of auction sites, I see many, many collections of such labels, from bars, restaurants, hotels, whatever, all over the world. But Japan is the land of woodblock printmaking, so you know where this story is going. It became common for those same collectors groups, the ones organizing the senshafuda exchanges, to also arrange for the creation of sets or prints in a smaller match label size. And those, Dave finally gets to the point here, are what we're going to look at this morning. Now, over the past years, I've picked up batches of these prints wherever I could find them, and I've accumulated a nice little collection, some of which is still in envelopes somewhere, but some of which has now become organized into albums, like you see here. Now, let's spend a few minutes first, before I talk more about these, just browsing some of these little prints, and then we'll dig in a little bit deeper. This morning, I tried to get the camera set up near a window so I could see these in a nice little light. Let's take a look at some of the video I took. Here's the set that we saw in the cold open. It's a perfect example of a nicely preserved set of little prints, including the original presentation envelope. That envelope has a postage frank with a date of December 30th, 1933, just 1 week after the birth that is being commemorated here, the new baby that could grow up to be the Heisei Emperor, who incidentally will be retiring in just a few weeks. These little prints have been nestled in this envelope all during his entire life, and they are in beautiful condition. This next set, entitled 12 Months in Toys, is just that. The prints are labeled with the months, and each one shows a traditional toy commonly associated with that season. Tell you what, let's do the unboxing in reverse this time. I have no envelope for this next group, but it has something a little bit different. A colophon sheet with a title for each print, along with the name of the designer. Now, these are clearly not professionally designed, and each member of the group must simply have contributed a simple sketch or drawing. These would have been sent to the printmaking workshop, who carved and printed them to order. I think the assignment that must have been given to the group members is clear. Come up with a simple design to show the concept, strength. The large introductory image for this next set shows a view of Kyoto. It's a reproduction of a Hiroshige design. And the rest of the set shows the stages of the old Tokaido Road. Here we are, Nihonbashi, Shinagawa, Kawasaki, and so on down the road until eventually we get to Kyoto. Each design seems to show some kind of edible, presumably something that perhaps each place was famous for. This would have been quite an extravagant production. I think those sponsors would have paid quite a bit of money for this. So, down right to the end of the road. Here we are at Otsu and then Kyoto. Then we see something common with these larger sets. It's a special appendix group of prints congratulating the organizers on successful completion of the project. Look at this close-up. Aren't these things so beautiful? Simple, yet so beautiful. This uncut set, it's dated 1935, and it's titled In Commemoration of a Trip to the Kanto, which implies, I guess, that it was produced by a group from some other part of Japan, perhaps Kyoto or Osaka, who visited the Tokyo area. Flowers, maybe they visited gardens, who knows? This is a special item I've got now. It's an album preserved from the pre-war period, and it shows how a typical collector of the day he would have stored his collection. Let's just browse through page by page. The drawings here in this set of 12 countries, it's very rough, but boy, they are still, you know, nicely made, you know. Bit of original spelling here and there. This is an extended set, and sometimes when they do this, they number, here we are, look, number 1, 2, 3, they've numbered all the prints to help you keep them in order before they get pasted in the album. This is the famous Chūshinguru, it's the famous 47 Ronin story. here's a 24, I guess. Yes, here, 23, 24, yes. Oh, this group, these aren't woodblock prints. They're offset printed. Let's skip over. Oh, there's two there. Look, up top left-hand corner. These two are local for me. This is the famous guardians at the Nyomon, the gate that was in front of Sensoji Temple before it burned down during the war. Here's another complete set. The envelope hasn't even been folded yet. This is the famous sites of Tokyo. That was Sensoji. There's where the 47 Ronin are buried. And Azumabashi, I guess. And there, the Ginza subway line must have just been finished, perhaps. Albums like this we usually find as a mix, you know, it's nicely completed sets arranged in order and then various random singles. This is another set of 12. What's the title up there? It says, I can't read the first character, something, 12 Beauties, Summer Edition. Yeah. Somebody likes blue. Here's another set again, 12 fans. Don't quite think they've got them in the correct season here, but whatever. Simple set. Nicely made though, simple set. 12 seasonal views somewhere out in the country, I'm not sure what that is. More random. That's a real match label, bottom right hand corner from an actual matchbox. There's 10, there must be two missing from this floral set. I'll have to try and keep my eye out if I can find them somewhere. This is a theme that's very, very common in the larger Senshafta prints. It's the fire brigades of Edo. Each group had their own symbol there. And you can see each one here that shows the men performing their festival tricks up at the top of a ladder. This is a curious set. Look at this. It's sports figures. This might have been for the projected Olympics. I'm not sure. 12 sports performed by skeletons. And there we go. Close it out. Now, when I first saw prints like this years ago, I was wondering about how they were made. You know, I mean, surely not one by one on little tiny blocks, you know, something like this. And of course, as you saw in that video, just as with postage stamps, they were for the most part made in sheets with different designs carved side by side and then printed together in batches. Most of them would have then been sliced apart for production and then distributed to the members of the collecting group as sets. As you saw too there, they were frequently packaged in small little handmade woodblock print envelopes to match the set. And now and then we find them occasionally as uncut sheets for the group members to cut apart by themselves. Now, many, many thousands of such prints were created in the pre-war period, but what happened to the blocks, the actual woodblocks from which they were printed? Well, we never, ever come across them, and there's a simple reason. These print sets were not made for commercial production to be put in a shop and then sold and then reprinted and then sold and reprinted some more. They were one-shot deals. The prints were designed, the blocks were carved, enough sheets for the commissioning group would be run off, and that was the end of it. The blocks would either be planed down a bit to be used again if there was enough thickness in them, and if they were too thin, into the wood stove to be used to heat the workshop. There was absolutely no need for them to be kept. And indeed, it would have been impossible due to the amount of space they would take up. But a couple of months back, one day in the shop here, we had a visit from Mr. Harada, an elderly gentleman who lives not far from here. We've met him before in these videos. His father was Kametaro Harada, who worked for the Doi Hanga Company in the immediate post-war period, carving blocks for many of the Hasui and Koitsu prints we have right here in our shop still today. As I mentioned in one of the videos I made for the Great Wave series, Harada-san let me have his father's old, long unused carving bench, which is the one I'm sitting at right now and which I've been using now for a few years. On this particular recent visit, Harada-san brought a shopping bag. He dumped it out onto the counter here in the shop and asked me if any of this stuff might be interesting for you to look at before he tossed it out. might be interesting. A random bag of stuff from a carver's workroom from around 60 years ago might be interesting. I gotta tell you, we've told him, we've made it very, very clear to him not to even remotely considering throwing any of his father's stuff out without at least clearing it with us first. Use scraps of notepaper, anything. Don't you dare throw it away. Anyway, long story short, there were indeed things of interest in the bag, among which was this. A woodblock clearly intended for producing some match label prints. It seems to be the key block for a set of 12. You can see the layout. There's the 12 designs, 2x6. It has a single registration system. I've got it upside down here, I'm sorry. And the printer would have run the sheets off, printing all 12 sheets at once. Now, I took a carbon paper rubbing from it this morning to help visualize the print designs. It seems to be something to do with volcanoes in Japan. It might be perhaps an onsen series. There are unfortunately no matching color blocks. Now, I'm going to put this aside for a minute and come back to it near the end of this video. Also in the bag was this pair of blocks. Oops, excuse me. What do we have here? Now, this is not 12 images, just 3 here. It's got one by itself with registration marks, and there's a pair with registration marks to look to work for the two. These two must have been printed together. Now, I have no idea why such a small group would have been made. It wouldn't seem to me commercially practical at all. But what about color blocks? And yes, right next to it, wrapped up in the bag, we have this. Look at this. Let's see. These shapes seem to match up. If I turn this around, those little shapes, yep, seem to match up. On the back side, this matches. It looks like we have, perhaps, a complete set of color blocks and the key block for a small pair of match label prints. Are you thinking what I'm thinking? Let's take these upstairs. Yes, here they are. It's not so bad, you know. It's a bit of a simple thing, a nice little pair of prints. Now, as you saw during that printing session, this pair of designs, they have the word Harada on there. They seem to have been created by Harada-san, the carver, himself. His son, the man who gave us this bag of stuff, has given us permission to use these blocks in any way we wish. Now, we've already used one of his images in our catalog. Remember the Kingfisher design that was our gift print last year? So let's do it again. I'll pass these blocks to Rei-chan, our youngest printer upstairs. And after she has a chance to make the batch, we'll put them into our online catalog to see if there's any interest. As with the Kingfisher, we'll pay a royalty to the sun for these. And those blocks, after sleeping for 60 years, will have a chance to come back to life again and spread a little bit of pleasure around the world. Now, before I close this off, I have something else for you. You know, one more thing. The block I showed you earlier in this presentation, the one to print the key block for the set of 12 volcano images. As you can see, by looking both at the block itself and what did I do with it, and the proof copy, each image of the 12 has a couple of small boxes. And it is in there that the title of each image, the name of it, would have been carved. Now, why weren't those titles carved right on this black block? That's because although this is the key in the sense of defining the outlines, it wouldn't have been printed in jet black, but more probably in a fairly light gray. The lettering would have been carved on a separate black block. There were probably maybe three or four other blocks needed. These are landscape images, so there would be a blue for the sky, something for the water, something green for the land, you know, a group of colors. Now, if you've watched many of our other videos, you know how color separations are made. The key block is printed a number of times, the color areas are marked in, and those sheets are then pasted down on new pieces of wood to be carved. And that's what we see on the reverse side of this key block. This was intended to be the color block for black. A transfer sheet has been pulled and a reddish pigment dabbed on to show the areas to be carved to print black. The shadows on this mountain, the underneath of this bridge here, etc., etc. Now, at this point, the lettering was also written into the waiting boxes by somebody using a very, very, very small, delicate brush. Now, this was almost certainly done by Harada-san himself, who we know was very good at that type of work. The sheet was then pasted down on this blank face, and he got busy with the carving. But this block isn't finished. Look at this. He's cut the areas in each design for the parts to be printed black, getting them all finished cutting, ready to be cleared away with a larger chisel. And then, right here, at this part where it says Nikko, the place name, this is the Shinkyo Bridge, Shinkyo Bashi at Nikko. He has started the carve. He has put the knife in, cut the first character, and then nothing else. Now, Harada-san passed away in 1963 at age 61, quite a bit younger than I am now. And according to his son, he worked pretty much up to the end of his life. Is this his last block? Was this the project he was working on right up to the point where he could no longer continue? His son can't shed any light on this for us. All he knows is that this stuff has been in boxes for all the intervening decades. Who sponsored this match label project? Whether or not it was continued after he left? Nothing. We know nothing about it. All we have is this block. The carving work stopped at the point where one character, the character of his son, has been partially carved. Before you ask, no, I am not going to complete this block. And I think this unfinished block is far more interesting, far more useful to us than a finished set of small prints would be. We're going to keep it carefully here in our collection, show it to people who ask to see it, and learn from it. And learn we can. You know, I was looking at it again under the microscope just this morning, and I was reminded again how delicately those older carvers sharpened their tools. We've heard this before. The lines showing where his knife went into this block are just so incredibly thin. How could he do this without breaking his blade? So no, we're going to leave this block just as it is. And of course, holding this, you know, I can't help but think ahead to when it will be my turn to leave the stage. You know, I mean, what job will I start and then leave unfinished on the bench? You know, I think perhaps I'd kind of like to get back to work. Thanks for watching, everybody. See you next time.